NCERT presents a story.
The 1 rupee coin. Next week, Gandhiji will come to our small town in Orissa, thought Munni, the wizened old woman. I may be able to earn something for his fund if I do some odd jobs like sweeping Mahesh Babu's shop. Munni hobbled up to Mahesh Babu's Lakshmi cloth store. Mahesh Babu, please may I sweep your shop? She asked. Only 8 anas.
8 anas? You must be joking. You and Ali always seem to be short of money,
retorted the shopkeeper. It's not for us, Babu. We are saving money to contribute towards our freedom struggle, answered Munni with a toothless grin.
Really? Then don't worry, Munni. Roopchand from Roopchand and Son's Sari Shop is giving rupees 5,000. Did you hear me? Rupees 5,000. And Abdullah Bhai from the Kirana Shop is donating rupees 3,000. So rest your old bones, Munni. Gandhiji won't even notice what you are giving when we are there.
That's true, agreed Munni. But I just thought, since he was fighting those people who killed my son, I would also like to contribute.
How much? Laughed Muchala, the panwala from Banaras. 10 rupees? 20 rupees? You know how much I am giving? Even in 100 years, you won't be able to guess. And if you do, Munni, my dear, half is yours.
Hearing his boast, the tailor Ramdas couldn't help piping in.
Money you've made by selling pan masala and zarda, poisonous stuff that ruins people's lives.
If people want to buy, why should I stop them from buying? I only supply. I don't solicit. Mind you, I don't solicit, growled Muchala menacingly. He clenched his fists and glared at Ramdas.
A crowd collected, most excited. A fist fight was about to begin. People started taking sides and laying bets as to who would win. Suddenly, honk, honk, honk. The mayor, in his fancy Austin car, latest model, drove up.
Stop fighting like fools, he shouted at the two.
Sorry, sir, stammered Muchala and Ramdas together. We were only discussing.
Then discuss amicably over a glass of garam chai, grunted the mayor and drove off, honking importantly.
Munni hobbled to Yashoda, who was drawing water from a nearby well. Please, Yashoda Bai, won't you let me wash your clothes today? She pleaded. Only 4 anas.
Wash your clothes? But you look so weak, laughed Yashoda.
Besides, 4 anas is a lot of money. Okay, 2 anas, please. Well, please, Yashoda Bai, we really need the money. Oh, okay. That's 3 anas, Munni winked, grinning a toothless grin, for the Mahatma's fund. Here's a banana from our farm.
smiled Yashoda. She wished she hadn't bargained with the poor woman.
Thanks,
said Munni. She ate half and carefully wrapped the other half in a newspaper for Ali, her grandson. Then she hobbled home to cook a simple meal of rice and aloo ki sabzi for both of them. 5 more days to go. Munni, want to help us cut carrots and cauliflower for making pickle? Said the Thakurji, who looked after the big bungalow near the sea. The Sitani, who owned the bungalow, was a kind lady. Her standing instructions to Thakurji were to see that Munni and her son were given work and lunch as well. Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday flew past. A blur of sweeping, washing clothes and dishes in different homes, cutting vegetables for pickles, or helping clean dals, red chilies and different cereals in the compound of the big bungalow near the sea. And that's how, with 2 days to go, Munni found she had saved 8 whole anas. To celebrate, Munni and her grandson shared an egg. But a day before the big day, Munni tripped and fell. The doctor charged 4 anas for treating her wound. 4 anas. Poor Munni. The pain was terrible and she could hardly walk. Limping homewards, she suddenly blacked out and fell in front of the Grand Bazaar on the main road of the town. Someone helped her sit down on the pavement. It was impossible to get up. Why? Why? Why was it so difficult to save just 1 rupee? Wondered Munni. Her thoughts raced. Should she miss a meal tonight and save an ana? Should she clean Sampat Babu's cowsheds and make 2 anas? Dreams, dreams. Her tired mind drifted to a happier yesterday. She was running down the stairs with wings on her feet, chasing Zafar, her only son. She saw him, so full of fun, so full of mischief, tall and handsome, getting into their car on that fateful day. His wife, Fatima, heavy with child, huddled up behind to avoid the bumps. Why must you visit the Holy Baba now? Munni heard herself grumble. The baby is due any minute. That's why, laughed Zafar. We need the Holy Baba's blessings. A few hours later, the police car came with Zafar's body riddled with bullets. Once again, she heard Fatima sobbing uncontrollably. Those British soldiers, they shot him. Her voice was smudged with tears. We were driving fast. They followed us and told us to stop. It was really late at night and we did not want to stop. They thought he was a spy. Fatima died in childbirth, and her baby, Ali, came to Munni.
Move out of the way, old woman, yelled the chowkidar. Are you deaf or something? The Gora Sahib and his wife want to get into their car.
But Munni had no energy to move. She vaguely saw the chowkidar bowing and scraping before a British soldier and his wife who had just come out of the shop. Something tumbled out of the white woman's purse and fell at Munni's feet. Munni picked it up. It was a beautiful hand mirror with enamel work. Ever so elegant, ever so ornate. She forced herself to get up. Somehow, she hobbled up to the white woman who was getting into their car. "This is yours," said Munni. She handed the mirror to the white woman. The British soldier looked surprised. The old woman was obviously very poor, but she had still returned the mirror. "Thanks, old woman," he said. He tipped Munni 8 annas. "I want to give her more," said the lady. And she took out 4 more annas and put them in Munni's withered hand. That made 1 whole rupee for the Mahatma's fund. Could she be dreaming?
Form a queue with your donations for our freedom struggle," shouted Bablu, the self-appointed town crier. Roopchand, Abdullah and Muchala stood arguing as to who should stand first in the queue. "I'm giving the most, so I deserve to stand first," shouted Muchala.
Munni, her 1 rupee coin safely tied in a knot at the end of her sari, stood at the end of the long line of donors.
"Mahatma Gandhi ki jai! Mahatma Gandhi ki
jai!" Ali stood with her, holding her hand. The Mahatma thanked everyone for their contributions. He specially thanked Roopchand, Abdullah and Muchala for their generosity. He asked Desai, his assistant, to keep all contributions neatly in the far corner of the room. "Shall we break for tea, sir?" asked Desai. "Please, sir, I'd like to give something too," said Munni. The Mahatma looked at the gaunt, toothless, hollow-eyed woman in front of him. Her lips were chapped, her feet cracked, and her torn sari stitched in many places. Was the pot-bellied little boy supporting, or was she supporting him?
"I know it's not much," said Munni, unknotting her sari and taking out the 1 rupee coin. "You've done so much for us. I wish I could have given you more."
The Mahatma got up. He took the precious coin from her old and wrinkled hand. "This is mine," he said to his friend, the industrialist Jamnalal Bajaj, and he put it in his pocket. Eyes moist with compassion and love, he said, "You couldn't possibly have given me more, sister."
The 1 rupee coin.
You were just listening to this story. Author of the story, Kumkum Somani. Narrated by Jitendra Ram Prakash. Production controller, Prabhu Dayal Khattar. Sound recordist, Amita Bhatti. Assistance in production, Dau Dayal Chaturvedi. Produced and presented by Vandana Arimardhan.